Hello everybody, welcome to this In a Minute tutorial session. In this presentation, I will speak about parabolic trough collectors and Fresnel collectors. My name is Martin Eickhoff and I'm working for DLR at the Plataforma Solar de Almería in Spain. I'm responsible for line focusing systems. It is a pleasure for me to teach you about parabolic trough and Fresnel technology. I will start with a general introduction into line focusing systems. After, I will speak about parabolic trough collectors and then about Fresnel collectors in more detail. Also, I will show you some examples of commercial solar power plants and then I will talk about storage systems and I will analyze the maintenance work of power plants with parabolic trough and Fresnel collectors. Finally, I will give you an outlook concerning important aspects in the future. In order to explain you the use of those collector technologies, I would like to start very general. Imagine you are living in a country with a lot of sun and you want to produce electricity and you want to produce process heat. So you need a conversion system to do that. This conversion system needs steam, and with this steam you produce your electricity and you produce your process heat. Normally for electricity production you would need steam of 300 to 500 degrees and for process heat production 100 to 300 degrees. So there are many solar systems that can do that. Here we see the point focusing systems. For example, the dish engine or the solar tower. Both systems concentrate the sun energy in one point in the receiver. You can see here and you can see here. But those point concentrating systems reach concentration factors of 1000. That means 1000 suns are coming together and finally produce a temperature of 1000 degrees. But for our steam production, we only need 500 degrees. So those systems maybe should take benefit using other process technologies. For example, the dish engine could use Stirling motor and the solar tower could use gas turbine for electricity production to take advantage of the high temperatures. Let's take a look to the line focusing systems. Here we have concentration factors of 100 and temperature of 500 degrees. Actually, the temperature we would need for our steam process. So the most important line focusing system is a parabolic trough collector we can see here. The parallel sun radiation is concentrated by the curved mirrors on the focus line where we have an absorber tube and inside this absorber tube heat transfer fluid can heat it up to high temperature. The other system or the other line focusing system available is the Fresnel collector. The Fresnel collector has many parallel mirror rows that also concentrate the sun radiation to one focal line. There is the receiver. Inside this receiver we have the absorber tube and inside this absorber tube also the heat transfer fluid can be heated up to high temperatures. So let's come back to our question. Which conversion system is necessary for our steam production? Actually, we can see parabolic trough collectors and Fresnel collectors. So line focusing system would be very adequate here. Actually, the parabolic trough technology is the most commercially used technology in the world right now. Let's take a closer look to the parabolic trough technology. What is a parabolic trough collector? And how does a parabolic trough collector work? We can see here that the parallel sun radiation are coming to a special parabola. And this parabola reflects all sun rays in one point. This point is called the focal point. And we have here the equation of that focal point. Z is equal to square x divided by 4 focal lengths. So really, the parabola depends directly on the focal length. But before we are in a two-dimensional plane and we want now have a three-dimensional collector. So what we do is to stick together many parabolas and finally we get a three-dimensional surface and the focal point is converted into a focal line. So finally, the incident sun radiation is focused on the focal line where the absorber tube can be installed, and inside this absorber tube, the heat transfer fluid can be heated up to high temperatures. The idea of parabolic trough collectors is not new. Actually, 100 years ago in Egypt, the first commercial parabolic collector plant was constructed by the American engineer Schumann. The parabolic trough collectors evaporated water to saturated steam at 1 bar and 100 degree. The collectors were connected to a steam motor and the steam motor produced the mechanical power for a water pump. The capacity of the water pump was 380 liters per second. Here we can see the design, relatively simple design, of that parabolic trough collector. In the center, we have the absorber tube, and here we have the glass mirrors. Behind, we have the structure in order to give stability to the mirror surface. Because the sun is moving during the day, we need a special gear system, we see here, in order to track the collector. 100 years ago, the parabolic trough collectors were still simple because only 100 degree and 1 bar were needed for the operation process. Today, we would like to do electricity production with high efficiency and we need about 100 bar and 500 degrees for operation. So that is why we need a totally different collector. You can see here in this picture. This is a real modern parabolic trough collector. I would like to show you the different components of that collector. The collector have foundation, pylon, steel structure, mirrors, absorber tube supports, a drive, a tracking sensor, and a flexible tube here. This flexible tube is necessary because when the collector is moving, this part, this absorber tube part of the collector also moves, but the connection piping system is still fixed. So between here and this point, we need a flexible tube. Before I explain you in more detail those different components, I would like to assemble a parabolic trough collector together with you in this slide. So first we need our foundations. And you can see that in the center of the collector we have a bigger foundation. This is because there the drive pylon has to be erected. The drive pylon is the fixing point of the whole collector and all forces are coming together. So the foundation really has to be also very big. In the other foundation, we can install the simple pylons. The simple pylons only have to overcome the radial forces of the weight and wind forces of the collector. And so the design can be not so strong than the drive pylon. After that, we have to install the drive unit inside the drive pylon. The drive unit is a hydraulic system that moves later the collector for tracking. Then we have to install the steel structure and the absorber tube supports. Normally, steel structure and absorber tube supports are assembled before in a jig. Then we can put our solar mirrors and we can weld the absorber tubes. But now the collector is not finished. We still have to install the flexible tubes in the inlet and in the outlet of the collector. And finally, we have to install our sun sensor in the center of the drive pylon. The sun sensor is responsible for the tracking of the whole collector. Now we finished our collector and we would be ready for operation. When you speak to professional people in the field of solar energy, or if you read some documentation about parabolic trough collectors, many times you read special abbreviations. So in order to explain you the most important abbreviations, I would show you the following. SCE means solar collector element. This is a structure element between two pylons. Here we see the SCEs. Normally, one SCE is 12 meter long. HCE means heat collecting element. This is one absorber tube element. You can see here and here. One HCE is about 4 meter long. The HCE supports are the absorber tube supports. You can see here and here. SCA means solar collector assembly, and this is the whole collector. And finally, HTF, the heat transfer fluid. The heat transfer fluid is the fluid that flows inside the absorber tube and is heated up to high temperature. Normally, thermal oil or water are used. Now we come to the different elements of the collector in more detail. Here we start with the foundation. You can see here a concrete foundation block with reinforcement steel bars. There's another option to have special cylinder foundations. So here a special drilling machine can drill a big hole in the ground. And finally, we have a concrete cylinder with reinforcement steel bars. This foundation type is cheaper, but it is only possible for special soil, because sometimes big stones in the ground avoid the working of this drilling machine. For the foundation design, also the wind speed has to be considered. For example, if you have a solar field like here, the outer collector rows are affected directly by 100% of wind speed. So the foundations of the two external rows should have bigger foundation designs. Anyway, you should erect a wind fence in order to protect also the outer collector field rows, because then the wind speed slows down up to 50%. For example, a Eurotrough collector foundation is designed for 120 km per hour. Let's talk about the different pylons. We have in the center of the collector the drive pylon with the drive unit inside. This drive pylon you can see in this photo is very strong because the drive pylon is the fixing point of the whole collector and has to overcome all forces. The simple pylons on the left and on the right side of the collector are different, are smaller, because here only radial forces has to be overcome. Here we see in the other photo another design of a simple pylon. The form is very similar, but the A-form is more closed, and we have additional reinforcement steel bars here in order to give more stability to this pylon. Now I will explain you the drive unit. You can see here in this picture. The drive unit consists of hydraulic cylinder and of this device you can see in this photo better, a hydraulic oil pan, a hydraulic pump and a hydraulic valve block. So the hydraulic system is responsible for move the whole collector. But when the hydraulic system is working, not only the forces of friction of the bearing of the collector has to be overcome, no, also wind forces have to be resisted. So if we have big wind speeds or storms, the collector has to be turned around to the protection position or the stow position. So in this moment, very high pressure is inside this hydraulic system. And so the hydraulic system is designed normally for 100 bar. In this slide, I would like to talk about the collector bearing. So we see we have two different types of pylons. Each pipe of pylon has a special bearing system. Here we can see the simple pylon bearing. In this photo, we have a closer look. Under the shaft, we have a special anti-friction layer. And here we have a clamp so that the shaft cannot jump outside that bearing. Actually, friction bearings are used for the simple pylons. But the drive pylon is the point where all forces coming together, axial and radial forces. So we need here a very, very strong and robust bearing. Normally, ball bearings are used. You can see here in this photo. Now let's talk about the collector structure. The collector structure, normally, you can see here in this photo, should be assembled in a special jig because the position of the different steel structure arms where finally the mirrors are installed has to be very, very precise. A jig tolerance is needed of about 0.25 millimeter. So finally, the structure tolerance would be 0.5 millimeter. So before you start the assembly process, you can see here in this photo, the whole jig has to be checked and has to be measured by different measure devices you can see here. The structure is very important for very high wind speeds. So the structure must resist maximal wind forces without permanent deformation. So, for example, in South Spain, 120 km per hour in stow position from all sides, this collector has to resist. So no deformation for high wind speeds. But on the other hand, we would like to have still operation for lower wind speeds. For example, wind speeds up to 60 to 70 km per hour, we don't have or we should not have excessive reversible deformation. That means we can have this collector in all collector position, we can operate the solar field and produce electricity. The structure must resist all normal operation forces without excessive reversible deformation. That is also important for the own weight of the collector. Here in this picture, we see when the own weight is too big, the whole steel structure is bending, and then the mirrors wouldn't focus very well the absorber tube, and we would lose a lot of solar energy. The last point important for the steel structure is the torsion aspect. Here you can see a normal collector structure, and here you can see the collector with torsion. This torsion is produced because the drive pylon want to move the collector structure, but we have bearing friction and we have rotating joint friction that goes in opposite direction of the drive force. So finally, if the structure is not very stable, we have a torsion of the whole collector. That means that the collector end is coming out of focus and we would lose also a lot of solar energy in our focus. This torsion effect is very important because nowadays people want to save the expensive drive pylons and have designs of very, very long collectors. So if you design very long collector, you should pay attention very much to this important torsion aspect. In this slide, I would like to show you different collector structure examples. Here you can see a torque box structure, and here you can see a torque tube structure. And in the last photo here, you see a double torque box. That are two torque boxes in parallel. They have special arms in order to support the mirrors in the right position. The torque box and the torque tube structure have special cantilever arms, you can see here and here, also in order to support the mirrors in the right position. Here we see the cantilever arms in more detail. This is an example of a welded cantilever arm. This welding design is very robust but expensive. So some companies like to have cheaper cantilever arms, and they used stamped steel plate arms with banded borders, you can see here. So the banded borders give more stability to those arms. These arms are very cheap but probably less firm. Some experience show that in axial direction the mirror can be moved left and right and finally can crash together with other mirrors. In this picture, I would like to show you the absorber tube supports. We see here a special collector with drive pylons, simple pylons, the absorber tube, and the different absorber tube supports. It is interesting that all absorber tube supports are inclined to the center of the collector. This is because this collector is still in cold state. That means the absorber tube is still cold and shorter, because in hot state, that means we have the collector in focus and the absorber tube is coming hot because of the concentrated sun radiation, then the hot absorber tube expands and finally the absorber tube supports are coming vertical, you can see here. This design is very important for the absorber tube supports because they have to be movable, and also very important for the design of the flexible tube connection. Because finally, for example, a Neurotrough 150 collector moves 0.5 meter to the right in the outlet and to the left in the inlet. So those movements has to be compensated very well. Let's take a closer look to some examples of absorber tube supports. Here we have the hinge high HCE support. The special ins allows the movement of the whole support. It is very important not to have big clearance here in this hinge, because then the absorber tube fixing point here would be moved to the left or to the right side. So when the collector is moving from one side to the other side, this point could come out of focus. That is why for commercial power plants, many times the spring plate absorber tube support is used. You can see in this photo. This is a special spring plate. This spring plate is banded in cold state and comes vertical when the absorber tube is expanding in hot state. This design is working very well, but you have to be careful that the quality of the spring plates are okay. If not, you would have big problems. Let's come to the last design I would like to show you here for absorber tube supports. This is a fixed HCE support. In this picture we can see this is like a steel T, and we have two fixing points here under the structure. So finally, if the absorber tube expands and this point is moving, we have a special torsion in this steel bar here under that structure. And this allows the movement of this absorber tube point. This design of absorber tube supports is working very well for short collectors, because then only short distances has to be compensated. Now we are coming to one of the most important components of parabolic trough collectors, the absorber tube. We have here a glass tube and a stainless steel tube inside. Between glass tube and stainless steel tube, we have vacuum. So we need a special bellow in the end of one absorber tube element to compensate the special movement during operation, because in hot operation the steel tube expands and the glass tube is still cold. This different movement of both materials are compensated by the bellows. Then we have a special getter here. This getter is responsible because after long time, sometimes several years, some atoms from the heat transfer fluid inside the absorber tube cross the tube wall and would come to the vacuum. So this getter absorbs those atoms and can so protect the vacuum. This point is our vacuum indicator. So we see in this picture that this point is coming white in this case when vacuum is lost inside this absorber tube. If the vacuum is okay, so this point would be dark or silver. Also, we can see here a special getter. I told you before, this getter is responsible to protect the vacuum. And finally, in the end, we have a special bellow shield or bellow protection. We need this bellow shield to protect those bellows, because we see in this picture there is a special glass to metal seal, so a welding area between steel and glass, and this area is very, very sensitive. We have to protect with a special bellow shield against concentrated solar energy. Normally, when absorber glass tube break, the breaking starts actually in this area you can see here in this photo. So when you want to erect solar power plants and you have to handle a lot of absorber tubes, please never lay down like here or handle those absorber tube like here, because here you bring a force, external force, just in the sensitive area to those absorber tubes, and you can have some special micro breakage and air could come inside your absorber tubes and destroy your vacuum there. The absorber tubes also have a selective coating. And what does selective coating means? That in the range of visible light, our absorber tube have very high absorptivity. So a maximum of visible light can be absorbed by our absorber tube. In the infrared light range, we have low emissivity. That means the heat losses by thermal radiation of our absorber tube are very low. So finally, typical absorber tube coefficients are, for a normal absorber tube, an absorptivity at 350 degrees of 0.95, the emissivity at 350 degrees of only 0.1. And finally, there's another interesting coefficient. This is a transmissibility of the glass tube of about 0.96. That means that 96% of the concentrated solar radiation coming to the absorber tube cross the glass tube and can be hit the steel, the black steel tube. So the selective coating together with the vacuum inside this absorber tubes finally avoid high temperature of the glass tube. Normally 45 to 50 degrees are only reached, and that is why those birds are still happy sitting on the absorber tube of a focused parabolic trough collector. Let's come now to the flexible joints in the inlet and outlets of the collectors. Here in this picture, you can see a ball joint assembly that connects the fixed piping with the movable absorber tube. So there is one ball joint. This is a rotating ball joint. This ball joint is installed in the rotating axis of the whole collector. The other two ball joints compensate when the absorber tube is coming hot. So let's take a look to this ball joint section. Here we can see an inner ball and an outer ball. The inner ball is inside and sealed by special graphite. This graphite can press from here and press from here in order to seal both parts. So the inner part can be moved a little in order to compensate special movements. Actually, during construction of those ball joints, you should be very careful, because if grains of sand can coming to those areas, finally, this grains of sand could destroy the ceiling, and then you would have a lot of leaks. So when you do the welding work of those ball joint assemblies, you should do that in special clean workshops, not outside. Here we see another flexible joint. This is the so-called rotating flex with hose. This flexible hose can compensate the movement of the absorber tube in hot state. And we have a swivel joint that compensates the rotating movement of the collector. So this swivel joint is installed in the rotating axis of the collector. But if we have a closer look to this design, we see here a special follower support. This follower support connects the steel structure directly with the swivel joint. So now, to overcome the friction forces of this swivel joint, can be directly done by the structure. When we use ball joint assembly, we don't have this follower support, and the force is transferred by this absorber tube support and then by the ball joint assembly. And sometimes we get some problems of bending of this last absorber tube element. So this design has a special advantage because no additional forces are bending our absorber tubes. Now we come to the solar mirrors. The solar mirrors are really high-flecting silver foils with 4 mm solar glass cover. The solar glass is iron-free and with high transmissibility. The total reflectivity of the mirrors are 0.93 to 0.94. Actually, that reflectivity we can measure after many, many years of operation. The mirror curve is adapted to the ideal parabola, with a tolerance of 1 mm. But even if we have an ideal parabola, the mirrors have to be installed in the right position. So it is very important that here the cantilever arms are assembled inside a special jig in order to give the final position of our mirrors. Concentrating systems have to follow the sun in order to concentrate all sun radiation in the focal line. So we need a special tracking device to do that. There are different options to do the tracking. One option is tracking by collector angle control. I would like to show you in this slide. Here in this picture, we have a special inclinometer installed at the drive pylon. This inclinometer measures the actual angle of the collector, and this information is given to our computer. Our computer can calculate the current sun angle using geographical data and the time. So finally, the collector angle can be compared to the actual sun angle, and if there is a difference, so we give an order to the collector drive to move the drive until reach the new collector angle. So this information is flowing all the time, and finally the collector is moved every 20 to 40 seconds to the sun. In the next picture, we see another device, but finally the same thing, because here we have a magnetic strip and collector, and we can also read the collector angle. This information goes to the computer again. The computer can calculate the sun angle and compare the sun angle to the collector angle. And if there is a difference, the computer gives the information to move the drive until reach the new collector angle. So finally, the collector drive moves again. Now we come to the second option of collector tracking that can be done by sun sensors. A sun sensor, you can see here in this photo, this is called a shadow wall sun sensor. In this picture, I would like to explain how it works. So we have two parallel PV cells here connected together. In this example, we have a connection in series. So we also have a shadow wall perpendicular to those PV cells. So if we now have the incoming sun radiation, so the shadow wall, if the sun radiation is coming from the side, the shadow wall gives a small shadow on the PV cells. In this case, we cannot measure the maximum electrical current here. Only if all sun radiation would come to the PV cells, then we would have a measurement of a maximum electrical current. So our computer can evaluate this current signal and to tell the drive to move until the maximum current is reached. That is a way of working of our sun sensor. There's another sun sensor design. This is the absorber tube sun sensor. We can see here we have also two parallel PV cells, and now the sun is shining and the shadow of the absorber tube is coming to our PV cells. Finally, the same thing. We measure the electrical current of both PV cells, and the computer evaluates and tell the drive to move until the maximum electrical current is measured. Actually, the tracking by sun sensor is very precise, but if you not have sun because you have clouds, or if the collector is totally out of focus, then the sun sensor is not working. So normally the collector used collector tracking by collector angle control and additionally by sun sensor. Now we are coming to the collector efficiency. The collector efficiency is very important because it describes the quality of the collectors. I would like to explain you the collector efficiencies in this flow diagram. Here we are coming with 100% of solar energy to our system. We have some optical losses because the mirrors may be not in the right position, or we have some special deviation from the optimal parabola form. Also, the absorber tube might not be in the right position. So this factor we can see here is responsible for the optical losses for perpendicular coming sun rays. If we coming to the next losses, that are also optical losses, but these losses are for inclined sun radiation. So if the sun radiation are not coming perpendicular, coming inclined, so we have additional optical losses, and these additional optical losses are considered by the IAM. This is the incident angle modifier. Finally, we have also heat losses. Those heat losses are because the absorber tubes are hot and we have heat conduction, convection, and thermal heat losses because of heat radiation. So finally, we have this thermal loss efficiency. And in the end, the absorbed heat that really is absorbed by the heat transfer fluid is the energy we can use for our system. So the relation between the absorbed energy and the 100% incoming solar energy is our global collector efficiency. There's another possibility to calculate the global efficiency using the single efficiency of the losses. So we have this equation to calculate the same global efficiency we have here. In this slide, I would like to show you the collector efficiency for a Euro Trough 150. You can see here in this axis the temperature above ambient temperature. And in this axis, you can see the global collector efficiency. The red curve is the global collector efficiency we measured at Plataforma Solar in Spain. You can see here that at higher temperature, the global collector efficiency decreases. And this is very normal because are coming higher when the collector temperature is going higher. So only if there is no difference between ambient temperature and collector temperature, then we have no thermal losses. Then only optical losses affect our collector. Let's come to the design point of our collector in hot state. So normally 26% of 100% incoming solar energy are lost because optical losses. 11% are lost because thermal losses. And finally, 63% of 100% incoming solar energy can be absorbed by our absorber tubes and can be used for our process. There are more important collector characteristics: the rim angle, the focal length, and the concentration factor. The rim angle is the angle between this center line and the line that connect the external border of the mirror with the center of the absorber tube. The focal length is the distance between the center of the mirror parabola and the center of the absorber tube. And finally, the concentration factor is the relation between the distance of the external borders of the mirrors and the diameter of the absorber tube. So finally, for example, for a Euro Trough 150 collector, we have a rim angle of 80 degrees, a focal length of 1.71 meter, and a concentrating factor of 82. In this slide, I would like to show you photos of real collectors. In this photo, you see the Euro Trough collector. The Euro Trough collector was designed about 12 years ago at the Plataforma Solar in Spain and is the most used collector in Europe right now. Here you can see the Solitem collector and the Accurex collector. Both collectors are very small collectors and the absorber tube has no vacuum inside. So those both collectors are normally used only for process heat generation. In this photo you see the solar light collector. The solar light collector is very special because this collector uses synthetic material in order to give the real right parabola form of the mirrors. The LS1 collector you see in this picture is the first commercial used collector in the world. And here you see the second version of that collector and the LS3, the third version of this collector types. For example, the LS3 collector is 100 meter long and the aperture is 5.76 meter. Finally, in this picture, you can see one of the last big size collectors that are designed in the last years. This is a Helio Trough collector. The Helio Trough collector is 191 meter long and its aperture is 6.77 meter. I told you many details about parabolic trough collectors. But the Fresnel collectors are also line focusing systems and also very important. So let's take a closer look to this technology. What is a Fresnel collector and how does a Fresnel collector work? Here in this picture you can see a Fresnel lens with different Fresnel facets. So the sun radiation is concentrated finally in this focal point. If now we use mirrors instead of those facets. So we have this Fresnel lens with different mirrors here, and then the incoming sun radiation is reflected, and finally we have the focal point in the top. So what we do is we convert the Fresnel lens to a Fresnel collector. And in this picture you can see the working scheme of a Fresnel collector. All parallel incoming sun rays can be concentrated by the mirror rows to the receiver in the top of the collector. And let's take a closer look to that receiver. The receiver consists of a glass window, a secondary concentrator, an absorber tube, and an insulation. The glass window is necessary to avoid that wind and dirt comes inside this receiver. The absorber tube is responsible to absorb all the sun radiations that are coming from the mirrors. And the secondary concentrator is also important because not all sun rays hit the absorber tube directly. Many sun rays have to reflect it again to finally coming to this absorber tube. So that is why the concentrator here, the secondary concentrator, is coming hot. And we need a special insulation in the backside of that receiver. This Fresnel collector, if we compare this collector to parabolic trough collectors, has two big advantages. One advantage is that this receiver is fixed. That means no rotating movement has to be compensated by special ball joints or swivel joints. And the second advantage is that the wind loads are very small because all mirrors are in the same height. So the surface where the wind could attack is very small. But we have some disadvantages also. So for example, the long focal length or shading between these mirrors that are very close together gives finally a not very good optical efficiency of this collector comparing with parabolic trough collectors. The other point is that we have also more thermal losses because we have no vacuum inside this receiver between steel tube and glass. So heat losses by convection are very high. Or finally, the heat loss efficiency in comparison with parabolic trough collectors are worse. The third disadvantage of this receiver is that this receiver might become dirty with the time from inside. And this is a very difficult work to clean this receiver because actually this receiver is closed by special windows and no machines can go inside automatically for cleaning. Now I would like to show you also some special photos, some photos of Fresnel collectors. This is a CLFR collector. This is the first Fresnel collector erected in Europe in 1964 in France. And this photo shows you the Austra collector. This collector is the first commercially used collector in United States. In this picture, you can see the PSE collector. This PSE collector is very small. This collector can be mounted in a roof of a house, you can see in this picture. And because of the small size, normally this collector is used only for produce process heat, not electricity. This collector is a Novatec collector, and the Novatec collector is the first commercially used collector in Europe. In this last photo, you can see the MAN SPG collector. This collector is a prototype erected at the Plataforma Solar only for research. This collector is still not used for commercial applications. I told you before many details of different collector types, but now you would like to know how can I use those collectors? How can I produce electricity? So let's come to the next slide and let's come back to our country with a lot of sun. So imagine you have your house in this country and you have your family and your family want to have light. Your family want to watch TV, want to listen to radio and want to wash clothes. So what you need is electricity for your house. And you are thinking, I have a lot of sun. How can I use that sun for my family? So you remember, we have our parabolic trough collectors. But if you have thermal energy from your collectors, finally, you need a steam turbine to connect to a generator that produces the electricity for your house and your family. The steam turbine needs a condenser for right working. So now you have the problem to connect the solar field to your turbine. How can you do that? Normally, commercial power plants use thermal oil to do that. So you have a first cycle of thermal oil. Cold oil is heated up in your collectors and the hot oil inside a heat exchanger is transferred to a second water steam cycle. So your turbine is running and your generator is producing the electricity for your happy family. This is one option to do electricity production with parabolic trough collectors. But there is another option. This option is called direct steam generation, DSG. So what does it mean? That means that instead of thermal oil, you have directly water and steam inside your collector field. So you have finally a very simple cycle and only one cycle to do that. That is possible because research work of the last 10 years at Plataforma Solar demonstrates that it's a good option for the future. But we have still challenges. The first main DSG challenge is the loop outlet temperature control. So we have to control the hot superheated steam that comes to the turbine. This, finally, we know can be done by special injectors that inject cold water inside the superheated steam before the last superheating collectors. The second DSG challenge is the local temperature gradients at the absorber tubes. That means you can see here in this picture, the sun is coming and concentrated to the side of the absorber tube. Inside this absorber tube, we have two fast flow. That means we have steam and water. When the sun radiation is coming from the side, the water cools down the tube wall very well. The steam cannot cool down the tube wall very well. Finally, we have temperature difference between this cold side and this hot side. This temperature differences could bend the absorber tube. And in extreme cases, this absorber tube could bend so much that the glass tube is touched and can break. So actually, this problem was really there, but because of long time of research, we right now know that if we take care of enough flow and turbulent flow inside those absorber tubes, the problem of local temperature gradients are coming very, very small. And if we take a look to the Fresnel technology, here we can see that the sun radiation are coming from all sides. So actually, the density of heat flux to the absorber tube is very homogeneous. So then this problem is not so big. And that is why the Fresnel technology normally never use thermal oil inside the absorber tubes. The Fresnel technology actually uses directly water and steam, because the use of DSG, of direct steam generation, has many benefits and many advantages. Those advantages I would like to show you in this slides. Actually, we have three big advantages of the use of direct steam generation. Advantage number one is that we can have higher superheating temperatures. And finally, we have better efficiency of our turbine process. Direct steam generation can superheat the steam up to 500 degrees. Thermal oil is only limited to 400 degrees, because if the heating up would be higher, the thermal oil would be destroyed. The second advantage is the cost reduction. Now we have only one water steam cycle, so no primary oil cycle is necessary. We don't to have buy the expensive thermal oil, and we don't need oil pumps, and we don't need the big heat exchanger. So we have a big cost reduction. The last advantage is also very important. Water is much more environment friendly than thermal oil. That means if you have leakages and if thermal oil is coming to the ground, you really have a big environment problem. But if you use water and water is coming to the ground, there is no environment problem. In the next slides, I would like to give you an overview of commercial solar power plants in the world. In this picture, you can see the SEGS power plant. Actually, this power plant are 9 separated plants together that are erected in California, and those are the first commercially used power plants in the world. There are 354 megawatt electrical power installed, and the first of those power plants are already operated during 28 years. In this diagram, I would like to show how those power plants are working. The oil pump pumps cold oil to the solar field. The solar field heats up that oil to high temperature. And finally, in this heat exchanger, the thermal heat is transferred to the water steam cycle. The turbine is running and the generator produces the electricity. This is the Undersol 1 power plant. This is the first commercial power plant in Europe. Undersol 1 is located in Spain, and 50 megawatts of electrical power are installed. The grid connection was 2008. And the interesting thing of this power plant is a storage system of 6 to 7 hours. So in this diagram, you can see again how this plant is working. The oil pump pumps the cold oil to the solar field. The oil is heated up to high temperature and can flow to many heat exchanger, solar superheater, steam generator, solar preheater, and also a solar reheater. So finally, we can produce our steam for our turbine, and the generator can produce our electricity. So when we take a look to this part of the plant, we can see here a storage system with a hot salt tank and a cold salt tank. The way of working of this storage system I will explain later. Here we see the ISCC Kuramat power plant in Egypt. ISCC means integrated solar power into combined cycle. So what we have here is a gas turbine of 80 megawatt electrical power and steam turbine of 70 megawatt electrical power. 20 megawatt of this 70 megawatt are produced by the solar field. How is it done? We can see here. So our gas turbine has exhausting gas, and this gas comes to the heat exchanger and produces the steam for the steam turbine. the solar field is also connected to this heat exchanger and give also heat for the steam production. So finally, our solar field produce steam and the turbine is running and the generator produce electricity. Now I would like to show you here in this slide the first commercial power plant of Fresnel collectors in Europe, in Spain. Here only 1.4 megawatt electrical power are installed, but the interesting thing is we use directly steam generation. So we produce directly saturated steam by two parallel collector loops. The grid connection of this power plant was in 2009. So let's take a look to this diagram. Feed water is coming to the collector rows and we produce wet steam of 234 degrees and 30 bars. In this steam ramp, the water and steam is separated. The water is pumped back to the field inlet by the recirculation pump and the saturated steam flows to the turbine and produces finally electricity. This installation are working very well, has a very small size. So that is why now the same technology is used for a bigger power plant, 30 megawatt electrical power plant, using two steam turbines. The Fresnel PE2 actually is the big brother of the Fresnel PE1, and also direct steam generation is used with saturated steam. The grid connection of this bigger solar power plant using Fresnel technology was 2012. Let's take a look again to this diagram. Here we can see that is very similar to the first PE1 installation, but now we reach to higher temperature and higher pressure. So those higher process conditions give us a better efficiency of our turbine process. This is the last slide I would like to show you of a very interesting solar power plant, because this is the first power plant that uses direct steam generation with superheated steam inside parabolic trough collectors. And this power plant is the TSE1 in Thailand. This power plant uses a steam turbine of 5 megawatt electrical power and the grid connection was 2011. In this diagram, we can see the way of working. 180 degrees feed water coming inside this evaporation field and wet steam of 230 degrees finally goes to the steam drum. There, the steam and water is separated. The water is pumped again to the field inlet and the saturated steam flows to the superheater section. And in the end, 220 degrees superheated steam at 30 bar comes to the turbine. The turbine is running. The generator can produce electricity. If we take a look to the photo, we can see here the big area of the evaporating section and a smaller area for the superheating section. Now we are coming to the storage systems. Storage systems are very important because other renewable technologies like wind turbines or photovoltaic plants cannot store very well their electricity, but solar thermal power plants can store their thermal energy very easy inside thermal storage systems. So I would like to show you now the main options for heat storage. The first option is to store the thermal oil directly in a tank. So that is very easy. When you have sun, you heat up oil, store it in the tank, and at night you take it out for electricity production. The second option to use a storage system is a fast change storage. This fast change storage normally is used for steam generation. You have sodium nitrate inside a tank and you have a lot of parallel steel tubes inside this sodium nitrate. The phase change temperature of sodium nitrate is 306 degrees. So what you do is, when you have a lot of sun during the day, you send saturated steam inside this storage system, and the sodium nitrate starts melting. So the energy is accumulated inside this molten material. So the energy is finally accumulated inside this molten material. At night, when you need electricity, so you can pump water to this storage system and you can absorb or transfer the energy of the liquid salt to the heat transfer fluid, you produce saturated steam, and this saturated steam can later be used for your turbine process and you can produce electricity. Let's come to the third option of storage system. This example shows you a concrete storage system. So you have a concrete block, and inside this block you have many parallel steel tubes. So you can do the same thing than before. When you have a lot of energy during the day, you send this hot heat transfer fluid inside this storage system. So the concrete is coming hot because the heat is transferred to the concrete block, and the heat transfer fluid coming out cold, in cold state. So at night, when you need electricity but you don't have sun, so you send cold heat transfer fluid inside this storage system and you come out with hot heat transfer fluid. Normally hot oil is used, but also water can be preheated or steam can be superheated by this kind of concrete storage. Here you can see a typical photo of those modules. Here we come to a very interesting storage system. This is a molten salt storage system used in Undersol 1, I showed you before in one photo. You see here a hot salt tank of 386 degrees and a cold salt tank of 292 degrees. The salt is a mixture of 60% sodium nitrate and 40% potassium nitrate. The melting point is 222 degrees. So you can see that even in the cold tank, we are still at higher temperature, so we have liquid salt in all the system. So how can this system working? During the day, when we produce a lot of hot thermal oil, so we can send this hot thermal oil to this heat exchanger. At the same time, the salt pumps are pumping cold salt crossing this heat exchanger to the hot salt tank. So this cold salt is heated up to 386 degrees and comes finally to the hot salt tank. So we really store our heat in a hot salt tank. At night, when we have no sun, we can pump directly cold thermal oil to the heat exchanger. And then we do the opposite. We pump hot salt across the heat exchanger to the cold salt tank. And then the heat from the hot salt is transferred to the cold thermal oil. The thermal oil is heated up to high temperature and can go to our turbine process and produce electricity. So here you can see a typical picture of those tanks. This is during the construction of the Undersol 1 plant. This is a hot storage tank and this is a cold storage tank. There's an interesting data I would like to give you. About 30,000 tons of molten salt are necessary to operate 50 megawatt electrical power during 7 hours. Now we're coming to the maintenance of the solar collectors. The collector cleaning is one of the most important maintenance aspects. I would like to show you here a mirror facet with glass and silver foil. Those facets finally, with the time, get a dirt layer on the top of the glass mirror. And then, when the sun radiation is coming, the sun ray has to cross this dirt layer first time here. After reflection on the silver foil, this reflected sun ray has to cross the dirt layer the second time. And finally, when this ray comes to the absorber tube, the absorber glass tube also is dirty. And so this sun ray has to cross the third time the dirt layer. So you can see for concentrating systems, the cleaning aspect is very, very important. Because three times we have to cross the dirt layer. And so we would lose a lot of energy if these mirrors and these absorber tubes are very dirty. So we need some special washing devices. I would like to show you in those photo here. Special machines can do very well the washing work. And also for Fresnel collector, we have here a special automatic cleaning device that can clean the different Fresnel collector mirror rows. But one important detail I would like to show you in this photo. I told you before that it is very important that in those receivers, Fresnel receivers, no air and dirt can come in. So it's very important for those Fresnel designs that there are no gaps, because then wind and dirt come inside and cleaning from inside is very difficult. So here I would like to give you an overview of all main maintenance aspects for parabolic trough collectors and for Fresnel collectors. So a collector focus control should be done daily. A washing of mirrors and absorber glass tubes should be done weekly. Changing of broken absorber glass tubes monthly and checking of absorber tube vacuum might be done or should be done every 6 months. Finally, changing or repairing of defect ball joints should be done very fast, because small leakages can be repaired very well. But if you wait longer time, the leakages coming bigger, and then you cannot repair the ball joints anymore and you have to cut and weld new ball joints. So you would lose a lot of money. And finally, you have to do replacement of broken mirrors only after strong windstorm, because during normal operation, you should not have broken mirrors. So for the Fresnel technology, you should also do collector focus control every day. Washing of primary mirrors and absorber glass windows you should do weekly, and the replacement of broken mirrors after strong windstorm. Finally, you have to clean the secondary concentrator after some years. And now we are coming to the last slide of my presentation. I will give you an outlook of the important aspects in the future. I told you before that thermal power plants can store the thermal energy very easy in thermal storage systems. That is a very big advantage, because other renewable energies like wind turbines or photovoltaic plants cannot store very well their electricity. That is the reason why storage systems are very important for our research in the future. So important aspects for our future are improvement and cost reduction of heat storage systems, development of big size storage systems for direct steam generation, integration of storage systems into commercial DSG power plants, demonstration of direct steam generation at 100 bar and 500 degrees, and testing of molten salt in parabolic troughs and Fresnel collectors. Because molten salt is a heat transfer fluid that can be stored directly in a storage system, and so the storage process would be very easy. Finally, we would like to have collector improvements by designing bigger and cheaper collectors. So this is the end of my presentation. I hope it was interesting for you. Thank you very much for your attention. Good luck and goodbye.